All right, then welcome to Your View. Good evening to you all. Our newsmaker tonight is Robert Mugabe. His body has arrived in Zimbabwe, much to the ululation of lots of people, guards of honors, you name it. And of course, this is ahead of his funeral over the weekend. Tate Maponga is my guest again. Hey, you are a regular now here.
It looks like I'm a shareholder now.
Thank you so much for always being ready to talk to us. Thank you. Are back because you talk frankly, and this is what this show is about.
Thank you.
We are not here to pussyfoot tea and so on. So talk to me frankly about Robert Mugabe. Mm. In your view, how should he be remembered?
When a big tree falls down, we forget what could have represented. We cut the wood and we warm ourselves around a fire.
Yeah.
Even the most useless of all trees still has value.
Yeah.
That people can sit around. And I think in the midst of maybe the last few years, that have kind of clouded a beautiful legacy.
Yeah.
People tend to forget, and I like you for one thing, objectivity. People tend to forget the good things that this man could have done. So if you can just allow me to become objective, I'll say both the good and the bad.
And the bad. It's a mixed legacy.
So that becomes truthful. Like in the words of the famous Shakespeare, I come here to bury William.
Not to praise him.
You know, I come to bury Mugabe, not to praise him. But maybe let's look at the legacy of a man who... Let's avoid the Hollywood mentality.
Okay. Which is what?
When one man goes to prison, he comes back and he's the one who liberated the country. And I can see that on the Madiba, wavelength.
Yeah.
I can see that on the Nyerere thing. I can see that on the Kenyatta, Kenneth Kaunda, and Mugabe falls in the same trap.
Yeah. It's because people are always looking for a messiah-type icon around which they can rally a cause.
But the danger of that is that now you begin to forget Sobukwe, you forget Biko, you forget other people. They run in the margins.
Yeah.
When in fact, the liberation of a country, it's a collective effort.
The collective effort of the entire nation.
Yeah. So firstly, we are looking at a man who sacrificed his life.
Yeah.
And I know South Africans, some of them, are excited about war because they think that war is just a joke. Mm. I went through that space where everything freezes, from school to hospital to roads. You can't even walk on the road because there are landmines.
Sure.
You have to walk on the bush. I spent 2-3 days sleeping on a tree, not knowing where my mother and my father were.
My God.
I've seen cow cattle being shot and being killed during war. So when you're looking at war...
Where was this?
Zimbabwe.
In Zimbabwe.
I was saying
during the time of...
During the times of war.
Before liberation. Yes.
So when you look at a man who puts aside his life and decides to go and join a military front for a liberation, let's salute those people.
Yeah.
Because many of them never made it back home. Mm. But you tend to have a whole loss of life and livelihood when you're sacrificing your life for the liberation of a country. So we look at the legacy of a man who could have become anything. And for all honesty, had he not been in the politics space, maybe he should have known the best educated man in Harvard, a professor emeritus, with the kind of brain language that he had. I don't think if he had applied his mind to a profession outside of the guns and liberation, that he could have failed in life. So maybe let's salute him for that. He sacrificed, and together with many others who went into that space.
Yeah.
Coming into the space of the Zimbabwean government, we want to look at four Mugabes. The first Mugabe is the individual, the person himself, and what he represented as an individual, as an orphan maybe, how he grew up, how he got educated, how he became what we know him to have been privately. Secondly, we have Mugabe, who becomes the president of a party. So Mugabe and ZANU-PF become one thing, to drive the agenda of reforming a greater national space. Then we look at Mugabe as the president of a country. Now you're looking at multinationals, multi-tribes, all coming together. And how did the individual in a party react now as a president of a country? Now the Gukurahundi story, the Ndebele story, needs to be spoken about. We cannot hide it under the carpet forever. It needs also to come to the fore. And finally, the fourth Mugabe is Mugabe the Pan-Africanist. The agenda that he represented as an African child to restore what every country desires. I saw a quote the other day which says Mugabe left his people with land. Madiba left us with poems, you know. Which I thought maybe. So maybe at an individual level, we cannot maybe pounce too much on that. He's an old man, and I think let's respect him that he has closed his eyes. But every background of every child tends to shape and mold the mature person that we meet in his future. So we don't know exactly when you look at him clenching his fist and talking like that. Yeah. What is it that is inside him that is trying to come out? Maybe the background, there's some other people who knew him better from infancy, could understand how his environment as a young boy could have shaped him to become the teacher that he was, to the politician that he became, to finally the Mugabe we are discussing here today.
Yeah.
So because every tree has its own roots.
All of what you have said sounds fantastic. Sounds like a rosy picture of a Mugabe. Even on those four quadrants you have raised, there's no Mugabe the dictator.
Dictatorship is a beautiful thing.
Until you're still coming to it. But these four, don't tell me the negative part of it. So the positive, yes, was a freedom fighter, right? Someone who liberated his people, somebody who clearly had good intentions at the beginning. It would be wrong to try to paint a different picture that says he had ill intention.
When you are playing the game with the British and the Americans, you are a darling. There is no other president on the face of the earth who received so much accolades and qualifications and degrees and honorary degrees across the world. Now, do you give degrees to a dictator?
Are you saying he wasn't a dictator?
No, I'm asking you. Do you give degrees to a dictator?
Before they become a dictator.
As long as you're walking the straight and narrow, we tend to accommodate you, praise you, walk you around the world. But when you begin to implement principles and philosophies that seem to mess up your friendship with the powers that be, that stand in the shadows, then your propaganda language and your starts to change and transform. I'm not here to protect his way of governance, his methodology of dealing with the opposition, etc. But not everything that is said out there about a person is true in terms of media.
But let's zone into the reality of his presidency. Okay, so he was a freedom fighter. He has brought liberation. Right, was in power for 30 years. Right.
Most of my life, actually, he was in power.
Yeah. In that 30 years, right, I'm saying that some of the results that we see is a collapsed economy of Zimbabwe.
Let me give you a nice one.
Right.
Before you collapse the government,
the government is still there, but the economy is collapsed.
Let's allow Mugabe to be the one who builds a good education system first, before we can collapse the government.
People are questioning that, they're saying he inherited it.
He inherited it, but he enhanced it in that he actually built. He built 4,500 schools during his regime, plus 13 universities, 8 polytechnical colleges that he put together, 7 nursing homes, and a couple other medical facilities.
All right.
So those systems are there. He did not inherit those.
Yeah.
He put them in space. He created more than 19,000 hospital beds during his regime, which are standing as we are talking right now.
Yeah.
Reduced the mortality rate from 200 per every 1,000 to close to 60 per every 2,000. The law enforcement and judicial system, we don't have rape every 8 seconds in Zimbabwe. We have zero crime, so to speak. Our nation is gunless.
Yeah.
If you look at dictatorship, the way you're looking at it, if it must be parallel with democracy, and democracy means weak-willed, democracy means people are free to get guns, shoot each other, and because the law protects the people, and you end up actually, look at what's happening
right
now.
What did he get wrong? Understand what you are saying, but you know, often when somebody has passed away, and I'm glad you haven't raised that, you have not waved that philosophical flag at me yet, right? No. Often when people pass away, right, if you go to the funeral of this person, right, and you know the person, and you have to ask somebody next to you, who are they talking about?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know who they're talking about. So here's a situation where people are queuing for bread. Mm. They are queuing for fuel, and they're queuing for a piece of steak. When 30 years ago, we would be exporting bread out of Zimbabwe, exporting, you know, agricultural produce and so on. Hence, I'm asking the question in a different way. Maybe dictatorship is something that we'll argue philosophically and not agree. Mm. But what did he get wrong in your view? As a person who is an observer of his presidency, what did he get
wrong? You're dealing with the people who moved away from eating sweet potatoes, eating groundnuts, eating round nuts, and having an appetite of bread and sugar. So it's a total colonization of appetite.
Yeah.
So that by the time you remove the sugar and bread, it's now a crisis. When in fact the indigenous foods are still there. I'm not blaming.
Are you saying the things that are queuing for, they shouldn't be eating them in the first place?
Why are the hospitals full if it is not because of diet? But I'm sorry, I'm coming on a philosophical corner, right on the extreme end.
Yeah.
But until your diet is colonized, the one who is managing your supply can decide what to do with the products on the right. Secondly, when the farms were taken away from the white people who were actually farming the wheat, now you take these farms. Sorry to say, some of the farms were given to comrades.
Yeah.
Some of the farms were taken by...
And the productivity plunged to new lows.
It's not what did he do. The question is the people who grabbed and supported and worked with him to take fertile land, which was being used for wheat production and food production, and to convert some of those farms into holiday resorts, where you get in there as a politician, and now, boom, you got a beautiful farm to yourself, and it's a place for buying meat over the weekend. So it's not only what Mugabe did. Maybe it's what he facilitated to do. But let's blame all the black people who actually worked with the politicians, who actually participated on the demise of a country. I don't think they loved him. They loved their money more.
So we should both agree then that there was a disorderly redistribution of land.
There was a disorderly honoring.
That was not planned. That was not followed up. People were given land and were not given support and so on. Stuff that's happening now in our country. But I want you to just hold that thought after the break, right? Let's examine what are the lessons that we should take from the reign of Mugabe all of these 30-odd years. We're talking about our newsmaker tonight, Robert Mugabe, who passed away last week and arrived, his body arrived in Harare this afternoon ahead